Filter-free radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott. It's a dirty job, but someone's got to do it. Radio or not, and filterfreeradio.com.
With a man by the name of Bruce Van Voorst. Now, Bruce is he's retired now, but he was a senior correspondent, 35 years as a magazine correspondent, worked 15 years with Newsweek magazine, 20 years with Time magazine. He also worked full-time for 3 years with Secretary of State Henry Kissinger, was senior correspondent for National Security at Time. A latter assignment included the Pentagon, the State Departments, as well as the CIA. In his final Washington assignment, he was the senior correspondent for National Security Affairs, covering military affairs, intelligence, covering the Pentagon, CIA, and Congress also. In 1992, he won the New York Publishers Award for the Best Reporting on Foreign Affairs and was a Pulitzer Prize nominee. He's been published in the New York Times Magazine, the Washington Star, Foreign Affairs, Foreign Policy, Christian Century, and other publications. He has also appeared on The Larry King Show and CNN. He's a regular guest and has produced 19 documentaries on national themes for the
McLara NewsHour. It's now just the NewsHour with Jim Lara,
right?
Because McNeil retired.
Right. And all of this jazz. So allow me to play for you an extended conversation that Scott and I had with Bruce about what's going on with the most recent Time magazine cover, naming the protesters the people of the year for 2011, and also talking a little bit about how Bruce, at 80 years old, has become so active in the Occupy movements. And I think this is very important to share with you, and it also brings about a little bit of motivation for those of us who might be needing it, a little activation for those who might be needing it in order to get involved in the movement. Here is our conversation with Bruce Van Voorst, and Scott and I will be right back after this with Buddy Romer, live on Filter Free Radio, filterfreeradio.com. Don't go anywhere. And I want to welcome to the program a very, very special guest, Mr. Bruce Van Voorst. He's a former senior correspondent to Time magazine, as well as Newsweek magazine. Spent 35 years as a magazine correspondent between the two. Has done numerous things. Your bio, sir, goes on forever. Has spent 3 years traveling as a press full-time with Secretary of State at the time, Henry Kissinger, senior correspondent for National Security at Time. Most recently, or his final assignment in Washington, was senior correspondent for National Security Affairs, covering military affairs, intelligence, covering the Pentagon, CIA, and Congress. I also want to mention in 1992, he won the New York Publishers Award for the Best Reporting on Foreign Affairs and was a Pulitzer Prize nominee. He's published in has been published in the New York Times Magazine, the Washington Star, Foreign Affairs, Foreign Policy, Christian Century, and many others. He's appeared on the Larry King Show and CNN, and is a regular guest and produced 19 documentaries on national themes for McNeil and Lair NewsHour. It's my honor and privilege to welcome Bruce Van Voorst to the show. Hello, Bruce.
Hello, Jacob. It's my honor and privilege to be on your show.
And thank you. Thank you so much for joining us here on Occuthon. We're broadcasting 24 hours nonstop in support of the Occupy movement. And a couple of things. I want to get into your article that you wrote. But first, I think kind of news, and I want to get your take, Bruce, on this. News of the day is Time magazine just named its 2011 Person of the Year to be the protester, citing the Arab Spring, demonstrations against austerity in Greece, and the rise of the Occupy Wall Street movement here in the U.S. Time writes, quote, "All over the world, the protesters of 2011 share a belief that their country's political systems, economies have grown dysfunctional and corrupt." And I would argue probably one of the most important pieces on Occupy Wall Street this year in any publication. Bruce, just curious your thoughts, if you've seen the article, and any thoughts on Time actually naming the person of the year to be the protester?
Oh, yes, and I just read it. In fact, I read it twice. I was so taken by it. I think it was a beautiful job of bringing together the diverse actions that are taking place in all these various countries. In fact, it reads chronologically because it starts in Tunisia, and then it goes to Egypt, and it gets to Greece, and it gets to Spain, and then to London. And it demonstrates how these things have crept across the nation, in fact, ending up in Russia, of course. But they also do a nice job, I think, on the movement in the United States, although my personal complaint, being a Washingtoner, is that they didn't give enough credit to the groups that I think you and I have both seen a lot of, and that is the two sites here in Washington, the McPherson Square people and the Freedom Plaza's people. But aside from that, I think the story, I agree totally with you, this is probably the most important thing that happened to the Occupy movement all year, because it gives a credibility to it. First of all, it spells out some of their arguments and some of their positions better than some people may get from reading some critical media, for example. Going down there is quite an experience, intellectual and personally, but intellectually, what you see is that there's such a spread of opinions and ideas, and they have grown up so much in these periods that I've been down there. I remember when I was first going down there, one of the big signs was "free hug," and that was great, but that wasn't really much of a political position. And they were really very ill-defined in their objectives. And I've seen over a period of time how they have come to define what their thinking is and what their goals are. And so it's been quite an experience.
I think one of the real driving forces behind the movement all across the country, all across the world, is simply the fact that they're attempting really to address the whole spectrum of issues rather than, you know, limiting themselves to one position or one bill or like that, you know. And of course they get a lot of pushback from the right and other.
Exactly,
you know.
Because I'm not enamored with that title, with the name Occupy Wall Street, because the movement means so much more than just Occupy Wall Street. Of course, they are focused on some of the things in the financial and banking institutions, and they deserve it. I mean, the way that the institutions puffed up housing values in the country with easy to get loans to people who really shouldn't have had them, they should be blamed for that. And for example, one of the objectives of the group here is to go to some of these places where foreclosures are taking place. There are 3 million foreclosures in the country, and that really shouldn't be happening. And but the point is that it isn't just the Wall Street thing. They have complaints and objections to so many other things going on. For example, one is hydrofracking, about which not everybody is totally informed, but of course it's that underground fracturing of stone and rock to get to gas and oil, but which is also very, very threatening to the water supplies in the area. And this is just one of the things that they go after. They are very much concerned about the health issues. They're very much, of course, a very high priority is jobs. And one, I think perhaps the thing that what I really like is that they have overall focused on the question of money in American politics. And that's not an easy thing to deal with, because they're basically two complex government decisions applying here. One is, of course, the Supreme Court decision in the issue of Citizens United. And then also there's the Glass-Steagall, the need for the return to Glass-Steagall. Now, these illustrate how difficult it is for the people to make their case, because Glass-Steagall is a complex law and has many aspects, many considerations, and many applications. And what they've got to do is get that reinstalled. Unfortunately, it was allowed to die under the Clinton administration. But the point I'd like to really want to emphasize, though, is that it isn't just Occupy Wall Street. I don't like that, but it is almost Occupy Congress or Occupy the U.S. system. But that's why I think you're absolutely right in saying that what you like, too, as well as I do, is the breadth and other complaints.
Yeah, I've talked about on the show a couple of times, you know, occupy the system, and, you know, kind of generally speaking, as kind of, well, it started out as a joke, but I mean, really, I mean, not so much anymore. But and Bruce, I know, I mean, you have spent so much time working as a foreign correspondent and overseas. And Scott and I were talking right before this interview, and he actually had a really interesting question that I thought would be great to ask.
Fire away, Scott.
Yeah, actually, you're singing my tune here with Occupy the System. I think, obviously, from my perspective, the system itself is broken. And so there's an infinite number of problems and solutions to be had, there's, in a much more broad sense, the system itself is completely dysfunctional, both political and economical. And in that vein, and a lot of it is due, I think, in part to the ignorance factor in our society. And so in that vein, as somebody who is a former writer for Time magazine, I want to ask you, I've noticed in recently, and there's been articles online about it, how Time publishes different front page stories in different parts of the world. And in fact, you know, Europe, Asia, and other parts of the world all have most recently had cover stories that were about revolution. In fact, the most recent ones, I think, Revolution Redux. And then meanwhile, the same issue, if you will, in the United States, the cover story most recently in December was, you know, how anxiety is good for you. And so that dichotomy in I guess, an institution such as Time magazine, I wonder if it's something you could speak on.
Well, I, of course, wrote for Time for a long time, reported for Time and wrote for Time for a long time under that system. And they're very proud of these regional editions because they are focused on the interests of the people in the area. So you have a European edition, you have an Asian edition, and that makes a lot of sense. It does create ironies on occasion when you get overseas, you might get a very serious political cover, and then you get Kate Middleton or something back here or something, one of the jokester ones.
Right.
I don't know if you saw all the possible candidates for the Person of the Year this year, but there were some pretty funny ones there, including Mr. Kane, who I would think is really not a serious consideration. But you're absolutely right. Now, let me pick up on this question of systems, because this is absolutely central to our discussion. We are all asking, what's next? Where does this lead? What is going to be achieved by the movement? Now, when they began, they were all anti-system. And there was a touch of anarchy there, but that really hasn't played a great role. But they certainly were all agreed that they do not like the system that exists. They didn't even want to get involved with electing people to Congress. They didn't like Obama. They didn't want to support Obama, not because they didn't agree with everything, but because there were some things they didn't like. Now, I have been preaching down there that at some point they are going to have to come to grips with reality. In fact, Barney Frank told them that the other day at a meeting of the Washington Women's Democratic Club. He said, well, it's fine. He's all for the movement, but he said that you've got to get roll up your sleeves and get down into the dirty mess of politics.
Yep.
Because ultimately, you've got to elect some people. That's how our system works. And whether the movement type likes it or not, you've got to get representation in Congress. And so I've been urging them all the time, and to pick up on what Frank said there, they're going to have to, as by the way, as the civil rights movement did, King learned this well, and the teabaggers learned it, as a matter of fact. You have to get people into Congress. Congress is where everything we object to can be changed.
Yes, and we saw with their kind of takeover of precinct committeemen in early 2010, and then just not but 9 months later, the landslide win in Republican favor. And that's, I mean, that's a brilliant point, Bruce, is that we need to not only become active outside of the system and support the Occupy movements and work to do what we can appropriately from outside the system, but also an inside the system game as well, getting people involved simply in the process. And we talk about the whole system in general. I would say, you know, all kind of resistance, all movements begin locally. And that's one of the reasons why I definitely wanted to talk to you, Bruce, because I'm here in D.C. I've been down to Occupy D.C. at least once or twice a week since it started a couple of months ago on October 1st. I was actually down there on day one when President Barack Obama drove by in the presidential motorcade, which was a sight to see, and cemented my enthusiasm for participating. And I wanted to also talk to you a little bit about you participated in the Bridge March, which was part of a nationwide day of action. And it was not but about a month ago when they marched here in D.C. to Key Bridge in Northwest. And you wrote, Bruce, in your article about how that was such a good model of what an action should be, and how they were able to, you know, clearly define their objective to kind of point out cracks in the bridge and how that stands as a kind of a synonym for this the nation's infrastructure in general.
Exactly, Jacob. I'm glad you should raise that because I use that so often in talking to people here. I emphasize to them that actions, as they call them, are fine, but actions have to have a point. They have to illustrate something, and they have to have resonance with voters. Now, the march on the Key Bridge was perfectly legitimate because it had out there the bridge, a very important and historic bridge in Washington, had visible cracks in it. It needs to be repaired. And it illustrates the national problem of the bridges and highways and the infrastructure falling apart. So, A, logically, there was a connection that made sense. And secondly, to carry it out, in my judgment, as these things should be done. They walked down the street. They took just one side of the street, but they were only maybe 100 people, so they didn't block the intersections very long. When they got near the bridge, where the traffic is really heavy, they moved off and onto the sidewalk. So they didn't block the traffic. They didn't irritate the drivers. And they made their point. And also, they didn't irritate the police. It was a perfectly peaceful, quiet, effective, I think, action. Now, in contrast to that, there are a couple of things they pulled which I don't like. Last week, they built in McPherson Square, they built a barn-like structure.
Yes.
irony is that technically and architecturally and from a construction standpoint, it was a genius job. They put this thing up in 3 hours in the dead of night. They snuck some of that stuff all in. And so I admired that. But the notion of spending $1,400 to spend this was ridiculous. A, they didn't make their point. Their point presumably was the homeless, presumably an aspect of foreclosures. But this is an illustration of how things get out of hand. They had agreed at their General Assembly, which all the groups across the country have a General Assembly, which is a town hall meeting in the afternoon, and they decide what they're going to do, yep, that they would put this up. But if the police came, they would yield and move, because it was obvious the police were going to take the thing down. But some in the group, difficult types, and they're always difficult types, decided to stay up there. So instead of making a positive impression on people, they showed the money being spent for... I stood there. I couldn't figure out what it was. On top of that, there were the television coverage was A, of some chap being taken off by a cherry picker, and another one urinating from up there. Well, this is not what you want. There was another example this in the same week. They blocked K Street. Now, in theory, that's a good idea. The point in blocking K Street, of course, is that K Street represents symbolically the lobbyists in Washington. And so they were trying to make the point that this is the street where all these high-paid guys go who go and spend all this money buying your Congress. If that idea can be made, it's a good idea. But it wasn't clearly conveyed. I watched it. I didn't know quite what they were talking. And on top of it, they blocked rush hour traffic for about 4 hours. Now, that is not the way to persuade people to support it. I kept thinking, my gosh, some guy sits there and he's eager to get home for their first martini, and here he is sitting in a traffic jam.
Absolutely. And you know, there's a right way and a wrong way to go about these things. And definitely putting, you know, thought into the full parameter of what you're about to do, all of the consequences that can come of your actions that will, you know, whether you like it or not, will actually be forecasted upon the entire movement.
Exactly.
And it's so important to, you know, maintain a cooperative, respectful mode of or, you know, choice of tactics in and like you say, effectiveness. How effective is what you're doing? How effective is that going to be? And have we taken into account all of the consequences that could come of this?
Exactly.
I know recently, just this week, was the Occupy the Ports on the West Coast. All of the
sea. What's it all about? I couldn't figure it out.
Yeah, and I did. We talked about it on my show this week about that a little bit, and how we I had someone on from the Port of Portland, Oregon, and he was talking about how, you know, we understand that they're trying to target the corporations that own the docks, and, you know, and the free trade system, the quote so-called free trade system, and kind of the epicenter of, you know, goods and services coming in and out of the country, outsourcing and et cetera. And he was you know, saying that I get that, but at the same time, shutting down these ports, you're hurting, you know, these members of the 99% who are port workers, who are truck drivers, who are simply just trying to, you know, do their day-to-day activities. And I don't think that movement or that particular day of action took into account the effectiveness of that and the full consequences of their actions there.
How did it actually affect the corporations? Zero, I would think.
Exactly.
In practice. And any delay of traffic bothers, again, mostly the 99%, so to speak, you and me.
Exactly, exactly.
But effectiveness and the relationship between the action, as you know, they call everything an action of this sort, and the intended message is the link that they really have to emphasize over and keep in mind all the time. And to go and stand on the street corner, well, this again is a Barney Frank, but to go stand on the street corner and shout America's going to hell in a handbag doesn't tell you very much.
Yep.
And that you know that I go down there and I do three things, actually. I listen. First of all, I want to hear what they have to say. I hear a wide variety. There are, by the way, people say, well, who's down there? I could talk for an hour on who's down there. There is a spectrum of people ranging from the very top of our intellectual structure. There, I talked to plenty of people with PhDs, MBAs. The other day, I had a very nice conversation with a young lady, and I said, hey, and by the way, did you go to college? And she said, yes. I said, where? She said, Smith. Well, Smith, as you may know, is one of the really elite Eastern colleges.
Yes.
And so I asked somebody else, do you have a degree? Yeah, he said, I have a doctor's degree in astronomy. And on the other hand, of course, there are others out there who are have no great skills, but nevertheless, the common bind in almost all cases, I find, is unemployment. That has brought a good share of these people together, and in many cases, they don't deserve it. They're eager to work, and that's why I was standing on the street corner the other day, and some guy in a car came past, rolled down his window, and said, hey, you... Oh, he swore a lot more than I'm going to do on this program.
That's okay.
But he swore a lot, and it's, the effect, the meaning was, why don't you guys get a job? They want a job, and that's what they shouted back to him, but they didn't use the words he used.
Well done. Well done, guys.
Yeah. Excellent.
And but then the second thing that I do is I watch. And then I'm watching to find out, again, to answer the question people ask me, who are these people? And I look around and I see a lot of serious people. Some of them, by the way, in Washington drop by. Not everybody that's involved and lives in those tents down there. But even the tent types vary. And in the education and background, I had a young lady I was talking to the other day, and everybody has been willing to give me their last name, except this one. And I said, why won't you? Everybody will give me their name. Why won't you? She said, because I'm in a divorce with the custody battle, and I really don't think I need that right now. Mm. I took that as a reasonable explanation.
That's quite all right.
That was quite all right. But the other day I had somebody that said, well, I can't see you tomorrow at 4 o'clock. And I said, well, why? She said, well, I'm finishing up my PhD orals.
So, brilliant.
that's the type that you get. And there are some others. I've got a very good friend down there who's an Alabama woman who's was battered by her husband, and so she still walks with a cane, and she's converted to Islam, and so there are all this sorts of people. And then I lecture. Now, my lecture is pretty much what we've talked about already, that you all are wonderful people, but you've got to get political clout. You don't like the system, but the system is the only way you're going to get any place. And I talk to the people about that. I also get them to define their goal. For example, when Wall Street's a terrible place. I said, well, why do you think Wall Street is a terrible place? And what specifically is Wall Street doing that you think must be changed and can be changed? And by the way, they raised one good point. I said, why hasn't anybody gone to jail from all the terrible things that have been done? I agree with that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we've got people going to jail for stealing bread someplace, like Les Miserables or something.
Yeah.
So, Bruce, what's the overall draw for you? What is it that brings you down to Occupy?
I'm sorry?
What's the draw for you? What is the query for you? What is it that draws you to the Occupy movement?
Oh, you mean me personally?
Yes, sir. You the stereotypical demographic is Generation X or somebody, you know, under 25, the students who are, you know, debt-laden with student loans and unemployed.
Uh-oh, and you saw on Google my birth date.
No, I didn't, but you sound...
Just as well. Don't say it on the phone, okay?
No worries.
I'm 79.
Oh, wow.
I think my brain is about 59, but I have a great moral interest in this. I happen to come from West Michigan, a Calvinist... I went to Hope College, which is a Christian college in Holland, Michigan, before I went to the University of Michigan. And I acquired a great interest in philosophy and religion. And as a matter of fact, right now I'm writing a book on the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Hebrew Bible. And so philosophy and morality and ethics are a central part of my being. And so when I see something like this, I immediately think that this is something that I want to get involved in, I want to support. And I think with my political background, after I've lived in, I don't know, 7-8 countries, I've been in almost every country in the world, but I've lived in 7 countries, like something like that. I've seen other systems. I've seen all the poverty in Latin America and in Africa, and I am really outraged that some of this stuff exists. And said, why do we have poverty here? Why can't we get a welfare system that works properly? Why can't we be dominated by the financial centers and the banks? This is just wrong. And this is, I'm a Democrat. I'm a big D Democrat, but I'm a small B Democrat as well. And I just didn't believe in that. I want the system to work, and it is not working.
I got to mention, Bruce, that you're talking about lighting the spark of philosophy interest. I just saw last week or week before last, we saw Dr. Cornel West speak at George Washington University here in D.C. And I walked away from that lecture, with overwhelming emotions and just...
And your head hurt.
But talk about morality and what it means to be human. And... absolutely. That lit a spark for me.
Let me mention that also that I spent almost 10 years writing a book on the book of Job in the Bible.
Mm.
And I never got it finished because it was much too complex. First of all, there's been a lot published on it. Secondly, I didn't have all the necessary languages. And thirdly, I wasn't quite sure what I concluded. But I did conclude one thing, and that is that I feel like I'm Job. I feel like all of us are Job. We are all struggling through. I have a great sense of humanity and community and compassion. And I think that comes through in the book of Job. And that's why I worked on it. I wish I'd published my book. I got zero per dollar per hour for my work. But I guess I wouldn't have sold many books either.
And I would add empathy to that list. I think empathy is truly one of the most important virtues that we can all begin to express more. And
Jacob, you know, every time I come away, I tell my wife I have learned so much about it. I thought I knew, but this is a class of people. Some of the people Well, they're more obviously they're more anarchic, if you will, or they're more they're certainly fiery independents, and which I like in some ways. Oh, they drive me up the wall sometimes. I spend an hour. I bought a coffee for a couple of them. I spent them all over the other night trying to persuade them at just this point of entering politics. Oh, they said, well, we're just 3 months old, and this is, we've got a long time to go. I said, but these things, don't forget they fade. This is a danger that you run out of steam, and the air will go out of the balloon, and all those cliches that I could think of. And I'm really trying to persuade them that they've got to bite the bullet, if you want another cliche.
Yep.
Excellent. Hey, Bruce, in that vein, I have another question for you. As somebody, I consider myself a lover of wisdom as well, a philosopher, if you will. And so I read, I'm not sure if you're familiar with the works of Chris Hedges.
Oh, sure.
Oh, excellent. Okay, former. Yeah,
oh,
former.
I read all his books.
Excellent. Son of a Presbyterian minister.
We play Hedges on our show all the time, Bruce.
Yeah, he's quite frankly one of the biggest inspirations I know in my life. And so,
I can understand that, yeah.
And certainly for our show.
About his physical situation.
Exactly. And so my question, using the context which I learned from him, one of the things he says is that obviously the system is broken. We're living in an age of neo-feudalism, we're actually...
I like that term, neo-feudalism.
Yeah, neo-feudalism. And also, it's also, what's the word I'm looking for? It's inverse totalitarianism. In other words, where more normal totalitarianism is where the state rules the economy. In this case, the economy is ruling the state. And therefore, it's inverse totalitarianism. And what my question to you in that vein is, I think it's well established, and I think much of the Occupy movement understands that we have a moral crisis in our society,
Absolutely.
So as you do the least among us, as Jesus would say. And so one of the things that Hedges has taught me is that the question is not how do we get good people to rule. The question is how do we get the people in power to do the will of the people. And make them scared enough of us to do what we want, rather than being more afraid of Wall Street or the wealthy elites and do their bidding. And so I was wondering if I could pose that question to you, if you had some sort of insight on that.
It's very difficult. If you've followed politics for a long time, you'll grasp the enormous influences that elected officials are under. For their primary purpose, of course, even when they don't like the idea, is to get elected, to get reelected. So the first thing they have to do is hold out their hand for more money. And the costs of running for office in America now have become astronomical. And so the little guy who really wants somebody to go there and represent his interests has difficulty getting people pinned down to follow through on what they might have promised. And this is why I mentioned some time back, I start my analysis of the problem with American political structure with the influence of money. It just everything is bought, and obviously the little man has a hard time competing, which is why the movement is effective in my view, because and to this extent we're showing people, maybe not dollars, but we're showing what the people are thinking. And you're quite right, it's hard to keep people honest when they get in the job. And, I don't know how people realize what it's like to be a congressman or a senator, but I wouldn't mind being in there and not having to get the job, but running for office and going out and then in your office you see their schedule. It's 8 o'clock, the Girl Scouts from Des Moines, and at 9 o'clock the Ladies Club from Des Moines, and at 9:30 you've got a vote on this. Then at 10:30 the committees meet. At 10 o'clock the committees meet. And so often members are on two or sometimes three committees. And so they have to go. So they go in, walk in. I don't know if you've seen the television coverage of them. And they come in and they sit down and they're marked present. But then they get up and leave. They don't really listen to much. For that, they have staff. And staffs are the center of real action in the Congress. But in many cases, they don't have to hear what the testimony is being given at these hearings. That's show business. On both sides, the people who come in, the general or the scientist or something, knows exactly the role he's supposed to play. The general has to come in and plead for the military budget. The congressman or senator has to sit up there and ask question, which is prepared by staff. He gets an answer, and what you don't see on television is he disappears. He's at Armed Services Committee there, and then he goes on to agriculture. If he's from the Midwest, agriculture more important to him than Armed Services. And so he's got to be there. And they're constantly going all day. And then there's a constant, you've got to see Mr. X from Chicago because he gave us $10,000 last year. That's how things go for these guys.
Yes.
Funny thing, I worked for, between Newsweek and Time, I worked for 3 years in the Senate. There'd be a vote coming up on the floor, and I'd prepare a really brilliant one-page memo describing what the issues were and what I thought that his position should be. And then he'd go down and get on the railway. This is Russell Building, going from one building to another to the Capitol. And he'd meet a senator's friend, and they talk about and he changes view completely. It's a really weird system, believe me.
And that begs you just sparked another question in my mind here. You'd mentioned before, I know from my experience and certainly from my perspective as well, a good portion of the Occupy movement, or at least the younger generations, are somewhat anarchical, or at least leaning towards anarchical tendencies. And sort of in that vein, the belief that the system is so broken it cannot be repaired and therefore should be replaced by a new system, what's cropped out of that is something called horizontalism, which is a term I believe quoted by Sheldon Wolin, one of the great political philosophers of our time, where he talks about how hierarchies are inherently anti-democratic.
Yes.
And that we need a new horizontal system. And does that sound completely utopian to you?
Yes, it does. I never really quite understood what he meant by that. I'll tell you the greatest irony I've experienced since I've gotten involved in this thing. Here we have all these people, anarchists, and they are anti-system, they're anti-our structure. And so I go down there, and what have they got? First of all, they have a general assembly every night, and nothing gets done except if it's approved by the GA. But it is a consensus operation. And so they've got to get everybody, and then they get into terrible fights, and they go on and on. And then they have committees. They have, I took a picture of their sign, join a committee. And there were 16 committees, everything from some fairly logical ones, such as sanitation and kitchen and library. But also they have an action committee that meets to just decide what actions they're going to take. It has a security. I sat in on a security committee meeting the other night. They have had some violence. And it's not unusual. First of all, you've got 200 people, in this case with McPherson Square, you've got 200 people crammed into a fairly small place, living for months now under very difficult circumstances. The other night, for example, it got down to 24 degrees. Well, yeah, I came home to my warm bedroom, but I had a great sympathy for them. I brought down every sweater and every long sleeve shirt and a couple of parkas that I found in my thing to donate to their what they call their comfort station. And
bless you.
A lot of people are doing this, and they're getting. I'm surprised they're getting some pretty decent donations. So I don't know what their financial. Well, they announced their financial situation. But anyway, my point was that they've got all these committees up, and they won't do anything, and they argue interminably. These things go on, but at least they had the other night. They had the sense to not do it. And standing out in the park, they went inside the Cozy restaurant, which has been very friendly to them. That, by the way, is also something very nice. Some of the Starbucks, for example, and some of the other places around have allowed them to use the bathrooms, for example. And as far as showers, which are also a real problem, the union makes available the showers here, which are only about 6 blocks from where they are. So, and they can go down there several days a week and take a shower, which many of them yearn for. By the way, they don't smell particularly.
Yes.
Just because it's outside, but...
For our listeners who are just joining us, you are listening to Occuthon 2011, broadcasting live, and we're speaking with Bruce Van Voorst, senior correspondent, now retired, but senior correspondent for Time Magazine, spent 35 years as a magazine correspondent, 15 years with Newsweek magazine, and 20 with Time, and an activist at Occupy DC participating. And Bruce, again, I want to thank you so much for your time. and speaking with us today. To me, one of the most important aspects of the movement, and in any movement really generally, is just simply participation, showing up, getting active. I want to wrap up and ask you your thoughts on how we can, because I'm motivated. I've been bitten by the bug, and I can tell you have. And how do we effectively kind of express this concern and get more people involved and really, really start sparking the interest in those who are, I would say, oblivious or just frankly not interested? Or is there a way to reach more people? Thoughts on that?
I'm talking about afflict the comfortable and comfort the afflicted.
I'm sorry?
Slowly.
I'm sorry. It sounds like what Jacob is saying. How do we afflict the comfortable and comfort the afflicted?
I sort of like the term.
Yes.
But there are all sorts of websites. There is an incredible amount of blog traffic on Washington. There's a Occupy Washington, D.C., and there's an Occupy D.C., which describes what's being done here, gives a calendar, and offers a whole series of other blog connections. But it's not difficult alone. I happen to come, as I said, from Holland, Michigan, and I'm in regular contact with some friends up there, and they've set up two, in a city of maybe 20,000. I would be one for the city and one for the lakeshore along the Lake Michigan there. But they pretty much did this on their own. They are not living in tents, but you don't have to live in a tent to express it. They get together and they talk about these issues. And the critical thing is that people understand what the issues are. And this is a really difficult thing because the core of all of this is the complexity of the issue. I mentioned Glass-Steagall. Glass-Steagall is complicated. Citizens United is a complicated decision. This fracking of a rock,
yes,
is technical. It's difficult, and so people have to be willing to spend some time on it. But they've also got to get involved at some point. As this is the most core issue of everything we mentioned, they can get together in people's living room and chat with each other. They've got to organize politically. They have got to, at some point, begin to approach. They can set up, they can name new candidates, but that's a rough and long and dubious procedure. They can name a third party, which in American politics doesn't get very far. What they've got to do is to put influence and pressure on the existing representatives that they have and persuade them of the merits of their case. And I think that that's the best way to get results. And because the movement is growing so rapidly across the country, and there are now millions of people, I'm sure that there will be a political fallout from this, and that congressmen and senators will have to listen to them as the numbers mount.
Parting words on that?
What a wonderful way to end this, because that's the way I ended my piece as well. I was casting about for a way to sum up all these many issues. And what is the bottom line? And we've talked about Christian morality. We've talked about compassion among individuals. And for me, the bottom line of the system that we're striving for is justice for all. And I think that if we should hammer away on that idea. It has an appeal to Christians should be paying attention to it, but every other humanist should as well. And I think that justice tells it all.
I can't say it any better. I want to thank again our guest for this portion of Occuthon, Bruce Van Voorst. He's the former, now retired senior correspondent for Time Magazine, Newsweek Magazine, Pulitzer Prize nominee, and New York Publishers Award winner. Thank you so much again. We're joined by Bruce Van Voorst. Bruce, thank you so much for your time.
You're very welcome. It's been a great pleasure.
Thank you. And welcome back, Filter Free Radio. My name is Jacob Dean. We are broadcasting live. We're going to take a quick two-minute break and be back live with Governor Buddy Romer, Republican running for president. And we'll get your questions, thoughts, and see how the presidential campaign is going for Governor Romer. Don't go anywhere. Filter Free Radio is live, and we will be right back.
Looking for filters? Check your coffee maker. This is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott. FilterFreeRadio.com. Get ready to suck down some grounds.
When I talk about resistance, I think we have to stand up now and carry out acts of nonviolent resistance.
Because the truth is, we do have power.
We live in revolutionary times, but the counter-revolution is winning.
Sounds like a case of the Monday.
Live every Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern, Filter Free Radio.
This is my favorite show.
We have been given an opportunity to make a new beginning.
I think it's very important for us to start to build a culture of resistance because what we're doing isn't working, clearly.
It's our job to very coldly assess reality and then figure out how to respond.
Your number one source for unfiltered truth, analysis, and solutions. FilterFreeRadio.com.